the next series coming up, which is going to be another cracker, basically. This has just had great series all day so far, but Bunny Hopper versus RDU. So we have Bunny Hopper, you know, as we said earlier, back from winter and trying to really, you know, use this last chance to really book that spot in BlizzCon. But RDU, one of the most popular players, the number one points earner in EU by quite a margin going up. How do you think this matchup is going to play out, Fireback?
I think Bunny Hopper maybe has a slight edge. I really like the face hunter in this sort of lineup. You know, it did lining up pretty well against RDU's hunter, lining up pretty well against RDU's Zoo, lining up pretty well against the rogue and even the shaman. So, you know, RDU might have to kind of change his initial ban plan and have to ban out this face hunter. It's kind of like an interesting deck that sort of popped up out of nowhere and has been working pretty well for Bunny Hopper in the previous series, and I expect it to do quite well in this upcoming match as well.
Yeah, it's something that Zoo players haven't really been used to too recently in playing against a hunter that runs double explosive, double unleash. You know, it's something that really counters that Zoo deck pretty hard. And we did sort of know earlier on today that Zoo is kind of one of the decks that we thought was a little bit of a risky take in this tournament because it's just not as powerful at the moment as it used to be in the current meta overall. But do you think there's any, you know, any key decks RDU has to win with other than the Zoo? Or do you think he's actually going to ban out Hunter? I think that's my main one.
It's going to be he's got the Zoo and then he's got... what else? The mid-range Hunter is kind of sketchy. It has the Freeze Mage to kind of clutch on. But other than that, it's got kind of awkward matchups all around. But, you know, I think it's just mainly the Zoo for RDU. That's the big focus point. If he's able to get a win with the Zoo, I think he'll be able to take the series. But Bunny Hopper's got a really strong target on Zoo with his lineup. And, you know, he's not just targeting Zoo. He's kind of like soft targeting Shaman while also kind of targeting Zoo a little bit on the side. And it just happens to work out so that RDU's Zoo is very difficult to win with.
Yeah, it's going to be a great matchup overall. And again, just to reiterate, RDU, the top point scorer in EU, going up against Bunny Hopper, the previous winter player. Here we go. You can see Bunny Hopper's points again. Just to remind you how he got here, the majority of points coming from ladder finishes with a good amount of Open Cups as well, and the 18 points there from the championship performance in winter. So just a very steady, consistent player. And then we see RDU moving over into like the heavy ladder points with quite an absurd amount again, with just you know, a good splash of Open Cups and, you know, some major finishes. He did win DreamHack Summer, which definitely helped out with the points and helped him get that number one seed. So do you think the do you think it's important to have a more wider aspect of point gains as opposed to the players that have gone all Open Cups, all ladder? Do you think it makes much difference in terms of like the quality of player in general? Do you think it's better to be well-rounded, or is it okay to just focus on one aspect?
I think the more experiences you can have as a player, the better you're going to do. If you're able to put yourself in it like tons and tons of situations, I think you're going to be more adept and a better player overall. Like, I think it's very important to explore all aspects of the game, from, you know, just general deck building to Open Cups to on-stage tournament play. And we saw that, I think, a factor thus far in the tournament. Some of the players that haven't had too much majors experience kind of fumbled on stage a little bit, or got a little bit tilted when they started losing and played a little bit faster. You know, the average time of their turns increased and whatnot, and they seemed a little bit flustered. So I think it's a huge factor, and I think it's very important to be well-rounded as a player and be committed to the game.
Yeah, it's one of the great things about the way the qualification process works in general is the points can come from ladder finishes, Open Cups that anyone can sign up to as well. They run like, I feel like there's a million Open Cups a day running on various websites. You can pretty much get into one whenever you want, as well as, you know, big tournament major performances as well. And in terms of play style overall, do you think Radu's sort of play style of just bringing strong, sort of straightforward, not straightforward in terms of playing, but mainly like just strong ladder decks in general, is going to trump some of the players who have brought more specified lineups in terms of really targeting one specific thing?
Yeah, I definitely think that bringing the strongest decks is a very important strategy, especially in the Conquest format, where we're starting to get to the point in Conquest where with the latest set, it's really hard to target specific decks. Like, targeting Shaman is near impossible. Targeting Druid is near impossible. So it removes the targeting strategy from the Conquest format, and then you kind of just have to bring the best decks. And if there's a player that's good at playing the best decks, it's either it's already you. Like, this is his strategy, his go-to strategy all around, and the format's just kind of perfect for it. So that's why everyone's expecting big things out of him at this moment.
Yeah, and it's been working out for him so far, and it looks like we are ready to get into the series. It is the first semi-final of the day. It's going to be RDU versus Bunny Hopper, and TJ and Frodan are ready to give you the action.
Thank you very much, Raven. Franco, that's right. It's time for our first semi-final. This is Frodan and TJ bringing you guys the next series. How's it going, TJ?
It's going well, man. It's going well. Been enjoying the game so far today. Getting to see some high-level Hearthstone. Some players, though, maybe choking under the pressure a little bit. But that's also fun to see. You know, who's going to keep calm under the pressure of their final chance to qualify for the World Championship?
Certainly. RDU and Bunny Hopper have done very well to come this far. You see already the bans in. Bunny Hopper, of course, banning the Hunter, something that we've been seeing commonly for people who bring Freeze Mage lineups, but don't ban Warrior because Warrior's not even available to RDU. Really interesting choice, too, considering that Warrior was a class seen just a month and a half ago as auto-include in all your lineups because of how versatile the class was. And now some people are not bringing it. And I personally like it. I like the choice a lot from RDU in terms of how he brought his lineup. I, too, am a big fan of bringing that strategy. I'm always on the fence of Freeze Mage, and this time I feel like people who didn't bring Freeze Mage might be the ones that come out on top, but I also stand corrected because guys like George C. always shut me up. So let's go ahead and go into game number one, Druid versus Druid. A very important match, I think, because the Druids are often the wild card of how they determine the series.
Indeed, yeah. And especially in a mirror matchup in this situation, when both players have evenly matched decks, Firebit mentioned it, and I sort of share the, somewhat of the same sentiment that Bunny Hopper, on paper, might be slightly favored. Winning a mirror matchup, especially when the decks are so similar, is incredibly important in Conquest, just because that deck is sort of out of the way for you, and you can have a little bit of leeway against maybe an unfavorable matchup down the road in a best-of-seven series. So yep. This is definitely a crucial one.
Yeah, the difference appearing to be one person running the Gadsden Auctioneer, one person running the Harrison Jones as tech. And of course, we do see that one Yogg-Saron is also missing from decklist. So we'll see if the Yogg-Saron ends up becoming the influential factor. A lot of times people feel like that is one of the swinging moments, but if one person's not, then we'll see who ends up becoming the victor there. Do you want to note that all these druids seem to be trying to taking in that Ragnaros as well? I think it's a pretty good inclusion, especially against the Freeze Mage that Bunny Hopper has. RDU's going to start things off with the Raven Idol. A lot of choices already. Mulch is not a bad choice, considering you know that Arcane Giants and Malygos tend to be difficult. Wrath is very flexible, though, and it is one of those interesting things that you have to kind of weigh your decisions. Based off your upcoming turns.
Yeah, one thing, though, is Wrath really doesn't find many targets against, you know, Druid mirror matchups. There's not many early minions. A lot of times you're using Wrath to cycle or you're using Wrath to kill a Mire Keeper. So Mulch ends up usually being more beneficial in a lot of senses, especially since the majority of the things that are going to threaten you the most are big stuff. Emperor Thorsand, Ragnaros Firelord, Malygos, and Arcane Giant. All of which Wrath is nearly useless against, all of which Mulch is fantastic against.
Bunny Hopper has two Innervates and a coin, had the choice of putting out that early Nourish, but without a clear game plan of how he would ramp into stuff, it's just not useful to cycle through the three cards of Nourish for two Innervates, so I think he just passes. Picks up Moonfire, so perhaps ramping towards Malygos can actually be a very good strategy. We are aware of both players' deck lists of how they both have a Mulch, though. So even though RDU is running the list that's more standardized without Yogg-Saron, I think he has to keep in mind that his opponent has that Mulch in his deck list.
Very true. Very true.
So I'm wondering how good is the Nourish for crystals. That means you have four crystals at the end of this turn and five the following turn. You still don't have enough to innervate into anything. So I don't blame Bunny Hopper for passing, perhaps saving the coin for the following turn.
Yeah, I think you can evaluate one more turn to see if you actually need to go for that ramp. Mm-hmm. It's pretty much going to be the same outcome either way. You just give yourself another opportunity.
Right. If you innervate Nourish on 3 mana, that means you'll have 6 mana the following turn, and then you can innervate coin Malygos for Moonfire. Mm-hmm. That is one possible line, depending on what RDU plays. And RDU's not doing anything either. So I have to feel like Bunny Hopper, with the fact that he's hitting multiple turns of ramp with the Nourish, will put him at a pretty big favorite. If RDU is not able to play anything in the next couple turns, and he's just stuck hero powering, which is the death of Druid.
Yeah. So I have a little bit more invested in this map as well, because I predicted Bunny Hopper to win.
That's right, you did.
The whole tournament.
And if I was on the pre-show, I actually would have predicted RDU to win.
Whoa, man.
I would have, because I feel like he brought a really good lineup, and I feel like when you also bring a lineup, it's not necessarily just the decks, but also your company of who you practice with. And you, and I, when RDU was thanking the people who helped prepare, obviously his teammate and, you know, also qualified for BlizzCon Tice. You look at Crane, Casey, some of these other guys who've been here to the championship. That's a really good esteemed group of peers. And I definitely would have felt like RDU was one of the favorites going into just how much preparation and thought he put into his one.
Yeah, RDU would probably have been my second. I'm a big sucker for storylines. And both these players probably have the strongest coming in, RDU being, you know, a very successful player in the past, being the top point earner for the season for Europe, for the year for Europe, and Bunny Hopper. There's two Virtus Pro players already in the World Championship.
Yeah, that'd be
how
pretty cool.
How unlikely and crazy and ridiculous would it be if three players from the same team made it?
All three. From the same region as well, which makes it even more competitive because there's less spots.
There's
to
less
go.
Spots. There's only four total spots. And if RDU makes it as well, he's on G2, and there's also a G2. So we'd have two G2 and two Virtus Pro.
Representing all of Europe.
Yeah, it's nuts.
It's a really interesting rivalry, too, which I don't mind either of these guys going through to the finals. Now, of course, Bunny Hopper going with the plan that we were thinking about, although he chose not to ramp, he chose to draw cards. And I know that that's a debate that a lot of Druid players go back and forth on. They say, how do you have to ramp because you want to get ahead of your opponent for better plays. But at the same time, Bunny Hopper says, if I ramp, I'm kind of all in on the Maligos, and if I know my opponent's running Mulch, I put myself in a position where I might be gas out of resources. And he sees that RDU's been passing. He hasn't been ramping. That's a third turn of RDU just hero powering. If you look at the match history bar, it's pretty much just that. It's hero power, Druid attacking, and then the Innervate Nourish. We've had two cards played, and, you know, over a dozen mana crystals available for both players.
Yeah, it's really interesting how slow-paced this is. A lot of times the mirror matchup is a little bit slow-paced until you get to a certain critical point in the mid-game where one player plays a big threat and determines themselves as the aggressor in the matchup. But that's a risky in itself. So I feel like Bunny Hopper, though, with all these resources, has to have an advantage. I mean, he's already pieced together a lot of the combo. He's got a lot of removal. He's got a lot of options. He's ramping, whereas RDU is not.
Yep, he already has Maligos available this turn. Probably ill-advised, considering that all he would gain is play Maligos on the board, and his opponent can mulch and clear the board while he's given up one of his primary win conditions. Because Druid, if you can exhaust the mulches, they can't deal with Maligos, and then you can just have this board, this very big, imposing minion that can't be dealt with. I do feel like removing the Drake is just a very good course of action. Chooses to just ramp again. Just kind of intimidating RDU at this point, having so much access to resources, and he has a full hand. So this is really hard for RDU to manage.
Yeah. RDU picks up Moonfire for himself, but this seems like as good as it's going to get for him for Emperor Thor's End. He's not reducing like any pieces of the combo, maybe Swipe if he could fit in with Innervate, but the big thing there is just he's reducing a lot of just raw mana from his hand. You know, Nourish being able to draw three cards for four, Rag being able to be squeezed in for seven as opposed to eight. He can play that as early as next turn, for example.
Yes.
So maybe not as far as, you know, Amalagos's Druid's standard game plan, which is to reduce combos and combo people out. This is still a very valuable Emperor.
I'm trying to count how much damage that Bunny Hopper can save up in the next couple of turns with Maligos, or even if he chooses to play Maligos this turn, but with only Living Roots and Moonfire, that kind of limits his options unless he wants to go for... unless he wants to save Swipe for inevitably when he plays Maligos with 10 mana. Mm-hmm. So if that's the case, then he's better off just Raven Knight only and see whatever spells he gets first. Looks like he is hovering over the coin, which gives him the availability. He can play Maligos in Wrath Cycle this turn. Okay, Moonfire. So by doing this, he's just not trying to go all in, and he's trying to test to see what RDU has. But the problem with doing this against an Emperor turn is that your opponent just had an opportunity to swing the board even more now, because Mulch costs two, and plus whatever minion develop is also cheaper.
Yeah, I don't really know about this one. With so many spells in your hand, and actually a lot of options outside of Maligos to remove the Emperor Thorstand, that seems a little bit early. It's a risk that, you know, he's saying if you don't have, you know, exactly Mulch, or like a naturalized from the Raven Idol, I win next turn, and he would have. He had So much damage. He had 18 from the swipes, yeah. 25 with the Living Roots.
And then he picked up Moonfire.
Would have picked up a Moonfire. Yeah. Would have had 31 damage this turn from hand, plus the 4 damage from Malago. So he set himself in a position where, hey, you have to have it. But I don't know if that's a risk that you should take in that situation. It's really hard to say, but RDU does punish it.
He was holding cards for 4 turns while hero powering. Mm. It is likely that he has situational removal. But, you know, not to be too upset about it, I can't blame Bunny Hopper for potentially just sweeping one game away from his opponent if he wasn't able to answer it. Now, RDU does see that his opponent plays as Harrison, so it's another weak turn, relatively speaking, from Bunny Hopper. Has to kind of say that he has a lot of removal spells. I think he can interpret Bunny Hopper's hand to be a lot of damage. He went for Malygos when very clearly he knows that his opponent's aware of his deck list, and he also sees Harrison Jones on 9 mana, which basically means he can play anything he wants. So he says he probably has a lot of damage spells and removal. How does that factor into his gameplay?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm still stuck on the last play, but Arcane Giant picked up from RDU. Still hasn't played too many spells because, like you mentioned, really just did nothing in the early parts of the game. But does pick up Feral Rage, which is a much more a easier way to deal with the Harrison Jones, so you can hold on to the swipe for, you know, more flexible removal later on in the game. He's okay with taking damage because he knows that Malygos is gone. So a lot of that potential for burst damage from Bunny Hopper is completely gone.
Yep, Bunny Hopper can search for some plays either through Raven Idol or Wild Growth. This is an instance where I actually wouldn't mind my
minion.
Yeah, thank you for reading my mind.
No problem, man. It's what
I was going to say Wild Growthing for a minion, which is also a case. Wow, he got Hogger, Doom of Elwynn as a choice. That is almost as good as it gets.
Might as well just Moonfire. No, I'm kidding.
Are you? I mean, I don't think that's necessarily the worst option. It kind of prevents it gets immediate value out of the Hogger.
Yeah, but you still have an Azure Drake left in your deck.
That's true.
So if you had no Spell Power minions left in the deck,
maybe
I'd go for it. Because then the only thing that you do is it deals 1 damage, but you could develop the 2-2 instead, which I think might be better than that spell. And I don't know. It'd be tough to say, but he does have Azure Drake, so he can turn that Moonfire into something a little bit more potent than 1 damage for 0 mana.
Always scary proposition when you have the ability to play things like Ragnaros onto the board, but you can't guarantee a hit on the Hogger. And Hogger, of course, will guarantee get value unless RDU chooses to mulch it. Now, he can mulch and play his own Arcane Giant this turn, which is not bad at all, actually. I mean, you present an 8-8 threat, and your opponent has to kind of answer it, and you know that your opponent would mulch giving you a better Ragnaros, because if your opponent spends his turn mulching your Arcane Giant, you can play Ragnaros plus some removal. So I wouldn't hate that play, actually, from RDU to set it up. But
yeah,
at the same time, you know, you have to kind of be cognizant of the fact that if you use your mulch, you're kind of out of removals for big targets. So if your opponent play his Ragnaros and shot your Ragnaros, you'd be in a bad spot. More legendary minions!
Wow. So this is how Bunny Hopper is going to win this. It's if he keeps slamming minions and keep forcing RDU to answer it. But he also has to find an answer to this rag. Okay. And he does have one, but it's very messy. He has to swipe Living Roots and Wrath. Picks up Yogg-Saron, though.
Yeah, that is one of the differences between these decks. RDU's deck, remember, does not have Yogg-Saron and the Druid, while Bunny Hopper does. The difference, of course, being that Ancient of War and Gadget and Auctioneer for RDU.
So far, Yogg-Saron in the Europe Last Call Invitational has cast 1 spell.
Total.
1 spell total. Yeah. A Flame Lance that killed itself.
Yeah, not exactly the most reliable form of removal anymore. It's definitely pivoted to a complete Hail Mary as opposed to a somewhat reliable Hail Mary. More like a flea flicker maneuver, TJ.
Mm. Indeed. You give the ball to Yogg-Saron and he throws the Hail Mary. Right?
That's right. Yeah, I guess so.
I know sports!
Sports ball is my favorite sport. Just FYI. Living Roots with the Drake just to kind of put out a little bit of damage. I guess he's charging the Yogg-Saron just in case he wants to play it. He has the flexibility of playing Gruul next turn as well. But I think he's anticipating RDU to remove. He has too many cards, and I think Bunny Hopper's plan is to Let RDU extend onto the board and try to get Yogg-Saron to impact a larger board as opposed to killing himself. But you guys have seen how unreliable Mr. Saron can be, especially if there's only one minion he can target.
Yeah. Ooh.
That is a very powerful card that can set up with two Moonfires.
Yeah.
So he can Wrath for three and cycle Wrath. I guess he's going to cycle first to see what happens. And RDU still has more plays available to him with his Arcane Giant. That will set up potential lethal next turn.
Yeah, there's actually...
Oh, interesting. So he wants to use one Moonfire so that he can draw cards and play the Arcane Giant. That's not bad, because he can pick up Living Roots.
Or second Arcane Giant.
Yeah, or second Arcane Giant. You're absolutely right.
But thing is, you know, a lot of spells were emptied last turn for Bunny Hopper. Right. Is Yogg-Saron something you think, or is it even worth playing around? Because I guess it's just as likely to kill itself.
You can't play around the Yogg-Saron. Plus, it's only one target, so Yogg has a high chance of killing himself.
Yeah.
And RDU actually hasn't given up his two-turn lethal because he has two swipes. In fact, if anything, it might have disarmed Bunny Hopper from thinking that he might have that lethal setup. It might make RDU feel like, might make Bunny Hopper think that his hand isn't bursty. When it reality is.
But, Dan, I think it's time.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like he has a reliable way. Unless he nourishes to get Mulch, he does have the opportunity to draw three cards. He could even combo with Fandral if he so desires, but that's not guaranteed. Neither is Yogg-Saron, though, and I think Bunny Hopper's weighing the odds right now. What's more likely to happen? I clear with Yogg, or I draw into Mulch.
To use a different analogy than your sports one earlier, it's time for Frodo Baggins to give the ring to Sam to bring it to the fires of Mordor.
Oh, it's Fandral Sam in this situation.
Yogg-Saron is Samwise Gamgee, that's correct.
Oh, we get
Hello.
It! And the Nourish into Mulch play pays off, weighs the odds. Now he's the one with Arcane Giant onto the board, and RDU is the one who has to answer it.
Not yet, Samwise. Not yet.
Oh, wait. His Innervate and a swipe.
All right. Ooh.
That's really powerful.
That's
and that should be the game.
It's one damage off of
oh, it's
lethal.
One off. Okay.
But the thing is that it clears the board and puts him to one.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't put him to one since he's going to swipe the Arcane Giant. Mm-hmm. But it is going to put him to four, which is... You know, it's still really scary to deal with because now Bunny Hopper, if he plays Yogg, which he sort of has to, he has to worry about not only the spells killing Yogg, but also the spells killing him.
Yes.
So
there's only four targets when you play Yogg-Saron, and you can cast a fireball in any of directions. Yogg-Saron number two of the day casts Battle Rage, just needs to remove the Mally Ghost. He does remove it, and that should be the end of the spells, but he's dead.
He's dead.
He can't do anything else.
Yogg-Saron has now cast a total of four spells so far. And a risky pick now for Dex, as we can see. Yeah. And Bunny Hopper falls in game one.
There you go. RDU wins Druid versus Druid. A crucial victory for the hopes of our Romanian player. And now with that Druid out of the way, I think RDU definitely feels a lot better given the fact that a lot of experts have pegged Bunny Hopper as the favorites based off deck lists.
All right, we'll see if Bunny Hopper can bring it back and tie up the series right after this.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Hearthstone Championship Tour Last Call Invitational. It's time to see if RDU can continue his path of dominance. Right now, he is up 1-0 over Bunny Hopper. The series is just getting started, though, so anything can happen. From here, we still have to have a few questions remaining as we do look at the remaining classes, which, by the way, I want to point out, 7 remaining classes. Pretty cool to just spot that. RDU has the Zoo Warlock, and Bunny Hopper has the Freeze Mage.
Oh, yeah.
And I think a lot of these question marks end up coming into the series overall. But the important thing is being able to get that Druid versus Druid win is a huge boost to RDU's chances of moving on to the Grand Finals.
Yeah, so those decks match up a little bit weirdly. But the thing is that RDU has a lot of Ragnaros to Fire Lord in his decks. So maybe, you know, there was a couple cards that fell out of favor. Hunters needed something to put in that 8 slot as a power play right before Call of the Wild, since I got changed to 9. Shamans had a couple of wiggle room with, you know, some of that early game with Tuskar Totemic and Rockbiter sort of rotating out.
Yep.
So they did have extra room, but the thing is that those rags can do a lot against Freeze Mage. Freeze Mage no longer has ways to make more damage from nothing with Archmage Incinitis. They've cut Pyro Blast. So if they have to spend damage to remove rag, then they're usually in a lot of trouble. And if they leave rag on the board, no freeze effect is going to stop rag from raining 8 damage bolts of fire down onto your minions and or face. So definitely something to keep in mind as well as you move forward. But this match can be a little bit different. It's Bunny Hopper's pretty unique take on a more aggressive Hunter and RDU's Rogue.
Yep, and he's playing some interesting cards. As we know, Bunny Hopper does have the more aggressive Hunter variant with things like Cat Trick to really mess up people's big swingy turns. It's not only, of course, effective against classes like Rogue, which RDU's playing, but also against the Druid, which tends to innervate a lot, play those early game Wild Growths. And then you also have Freeze Mage kind of being the mix there. RDU doesn't have it, but it's proven to be pretty useful in the past. Now, the thing about the Rogue and why it's been becoming more popular is because aggressive strategies such as the Shaman have actually been falling out of favor. So Rogue tends to get much better the slower the meta gets. That's why I felt like Facehunter was such an interesting pick here, despite the fact that most people don't really miss that deck.
No, not at all. And his face hunter is weird. His face hunter kind of looks like...
like a secret face hunter?
Yeah, it's like a secret face hunter. It kind of looks like if I had built an Hunter Arena deck, if I wanted to like get my wins out of the way really quickly.
Yeah.
It tops out at Leroy Jenkins, and before Leroy, it's Unleash the Hounds is the highest on the curve. So
it's like a 1-3 mana card deck, but then you have Leroy kind of thrown in there as your finisher.
Yeah.
It's very interesting indeed, and I'm really curious to... if Bunny Hopper makes it to the next round, Ultimate Blitzcon, I'd love to get to pick his brain on how he chose his decks and interview him. RDU, of course, on the coin, has things like SI7 Agent, very powerful ways to swing tempo. I think he's also aware of Bunny Hopper's deck list, which run pretty much everything that's annoying. He's got Cat Tricks, Freezing Traps, Snake Trap, Explosive Trap. So basically anything you do, you're going to run into some kind of trap.
Yeah. And since there's so many traps, even though you know the deck lists, you have no idea what that trap could be.
Absolutely.
Unless many traps were played before it.
Yeah.
How many times can we say trap in a single cast?
I don't know, but it's going to happen a lot this game, considering that Bunny Hopper plays the Cat Trick. Understanding that RDU would love to coin out the Tomb Pillager normally on this turn. He doesn't have the Tomb Pillager, but... you know, it's still already problematic. RD has to think, okay, what is he likely to do? Is this a snake trap because he doesn't want me to attack the 1-1 and backstab it perhaps? Or, you know, do I want to play a minion to try to bait out Freezing Trap? A lot of mind games go into this one.
Well, Questing Adventure is going to come down the board, which rules out absolutely nothing as far as the traps go.
No snipe. Okay, Bunny Hopper can play the Freezing Trap. Now, the problem with Bunny Hopper's hand is that he does tend to be a little bit more aggressive with things like Leroy Jenkins and Argent Horse Riders in the deck, but he's also lacking the early game drops. He doesn't have Secret Keeper, doesn't have his Argent Squire or Fiery Bats, all those one drops that really help him get that damage in, which this has always been one of the banes of Secret Hunter to any degree, whether it's slower or faster. Is that it does tend to draw awkwardly a lot of the times.
Yeah, but the thing is, a lot of times, even if you draw awkwardly, it makes things even more awkward for your opponent at times. Because even if you draw, like, all secrets early, as long as you whittle in your hero power, by the time your opponent can sort of safely play around all of those secrets, you already have them sort of whittled down to a point where you can normally win the game. It's much more of, like, a grindy deck that can get off to explosive starts. It's the same with sort of the Secret Hunter that many of you have probably seen on Ladder that runs like Azure Drakes, a list that the core of it sort of originated from a few players, but I think VLPS might have been the first to experiment with it. That deck, you spend so much time in the early game sort of trying to make the traps do less, but then they just hit you with like Curator Call of the Wild, Rag,
and sometimes High
Main. Yeah. And so by the time you get to that point, a lot of times, like, it's already too late. You don't have a chance to come back in the match. So that's where its power lies. I feel it's a little bit different than other Hunter decks.
Yeah, it's actually not as aggressive when you think about it. It's actually very combo-y in terms of the way it kind of pieces everything together and damage it over time. Get you within a certain range and then push for damage. Which is why some people experimented with Lock and Load originally with this deck list. They started putting Lock and Load, Cloaked Huntress, and then start going the Secret Roulette, almost as if you're playing the old Mysterious Challenger decks, where you're trying to play five Secrets and then reload on the random stuff. Sometimes you get like Stable Master and Forlorn Stalker and Tundra Rhinos. They always awkward forgotten cards of Hunter, so to speak. Mm. Bunny Hopper here, again, introduced with an interesting predicament where he quickshotted the previous questing adventure because he didn't trust the Freezing Trap, and he felt like he can get better Freezing Trap value on things like Tomb Pillager. So does he quickshot this one, or does he commit resources such as popping his opponents or popping his grandmother by using Unleash the Hounds to finish it off? Chooses to use Hunter's Mark. Okay, some of these plays are very interesting, and I admit I haven't really played much of this Secret Hunter at all. I'm a little bit perplexed about some of these plays, TJ.
I think what he's trying to do is play to his curve as best as possible and also sort of empty his hand of cards that aren't going to have much use, because eventually he's going to be in a situation where he's going to want to use that quick shot to cycle, to deal damage and cycle.
Gotcha.
And in that case, he doesn't want to have to use Hunter's Mark in a case where it's going to be, you know, detrimental to himself. Or where he doesn't even have a target in the first place to play it on and ends up with a dead card in his hand. So I think it's always going to find a decent target, but it's better to use it early than it is to, you know, be stuck with it later on without a relatively decent target. But, I mean, that's just a lot of damage right there. Like, he's already starting to whittle him down. But the thing is it's also, you know, a pretty scary board coming at him from the other side, even with the Freezing Trap up.
Yeah, I think you hit the nail on the head. The Bunny Hopper has an aggressive hand, and he can't necessarily guarantee that Hunter's Mark will convert to bigger damage, but he can wait for Unleash the Hounds to form more minions on the board so he can get more damage in. And the question becomes, how does he start weaving in everything? He definitely wants to push damage, but then Rogue also just played a very big swing turn. Coin SI7 agent into Edward Van Cleef is 9 power on the board, and that's no joke considering that you know Rogue has abilities to add more damage onto the board.
Yeah.
So if Bunny Hopper chooses to be aggressive, normally you play this and then Kill Command face and Hero Power and just go all face. But I think he might even reconsider depending on how things go. He's choosing instead to go with the Unleash the Hounds, which removes his ability to guarantee a beast from the Kill Command. And I think he's hoping that his opponent doesn't have Fan of Knives here, so that way he can't clear easily.
Yeah, I think in this situation you sort of have to take those kind of risks. You know, it's a very small risk, you know, not being able to get a beast from Kill Command. But, you know, if you think about it, it's actually kind of a big deal, considering this deck really doesn't run many beasts. It's got Fiery Bat, Kindly Grandmother, and Unleash the Hounds. That's effectively it, unless you get the proc on your one and only copy of Snake Trap. So it is a risk, but one that he sort of has to take to maximize the amount of damage that he's going to be able to put out over the series.
Yeah, and you know what? I really like it because Bunny Hopper says if you don't have Fan of Knives, then you can't really deal with these Hound tokens, and I can get more than just 2 damage. I can get 3, maybe even 4 damage. And I don't think he wants to spend his turn clearing all the beasts out individually. He might even just go face and try to race his opponent, because RDU, as much as he'd love to just play defensive, he also has to find a way to win the game.
Yeah.
And if he just plays super passive, how much turns is he giving for the Hunter to kill him?
Weird that he chose the Secret Keeper. So, okay. So, if you go face there, it limits the amount of turns that your opponent has to kill you. So that effectively, if you say it reduces the game time by 1 turn, you're reducing the amount of damage that the Hunter can do by at least 2 damage. Mm-hmm. If you take out the Hound, then you reduce it by potentially 3, you know, considering the Unleash the Hound's attack and the extra 2 damage from Kill Command.
Right.
And if you take out the Secret Keeper, it's really only like a maximum of 2, considering that he's probably only going to play 1 secret next turn, considering he had chances to play all the secrets the previous turn. So I would think that the Secret Keeper would be the least of his worries in that situation, given the fact that he only has like 1 or 2 more turns in this game to even live. So that's a really interesting attack, and one that I'm not sure the exact math of, but right off the bat I feel like that's can't be the most the best percentage play.
But I kind of like the way Bunny Hopper has played this game. He's really squeezed out every bit of damage he can. As a result, he has a guaranteed kill next turn with Quickshot no matter what happens. And it could have been easy, like, he could have been easily off the mark if he wasn't able to squeeze out this Unleash the Hound's damage to 4 the way he did. He'd be 1 or 2 points off. Right now, RDU is forced to play this Tomb Pillager, try to maximize his damage. So that way he has... Oh, is he just going to eviscerate the face? Okay, this is also a way for him to potentially set up for the lethals, but... I mean, we all know that Bunny Hopper has the damage in, and a lot has to do with the fact that he was able to make do with the fact that his hand was pretty awkward. He had 2 quick shots, a kill command, and like 4 secrets. That was his opening in.
Yeah, and like I said, just sort of sneaks up on you sometimes. You know, it's a grindy deck. A lot of times it doesn't necessarily blow you out. It just wins, you know, by 1 turn, 2 turns maybe, very close towards the end. So Bunny Hopper ties up the series 1-1.
Secret Hunter, man.
Oh, yeah.
How legit is this deck, man? I do feel like it flourishes more in a tournament setting than the ladder setting. But the more I see Secret Hunter, a lot of times I wonder, how does this deck seems fairly consistent, despite the fact that I feel like on paper it shouldn't be.
Well, Dan, it's too legit to quit.
God. That's a sign for a break, DJ.
It is. We'll be right back with game number 3.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Last Call Invitational. It's currently tied 1-1 between Bunny Hopper and RDU, and all of a sudden, the best of 7 has reset to a best of 5. And so far, we've had an interesting amount of diversity in the metagame so far of this tournament. I've been pretty satisfied with it. One thing I am sad, though, TJ, all the Arena Warlocks are dead. They died in the round of 8. And it's a little bit disappointing considering that Reno Warlock is not only just a favorite of many players, but also a fan favorite because they love Reno Jackson.
Yeah, they were on the endangered species list for a while.
Yeah, along with bees and polar bears casters.
But the committee for endangered species actually took them off the list. But they made a mistake.
Did they?
And now they're extinct anyway.
I guess so.
People started to, all the players here started to poach them because they thought that, you know, it's okay now.
Let it be a lesson. It's a real thing.
It is.
Reno locks matter.
Bees matter.
Reno locks lives matter.
It's a lesson. It's a life lesson.
It's the next hashtag, decks out for Reno. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's take a look at the remaining classes here. RDU has Rogue, Shaman, and Warlock. Keep in mind that is Zoo Warlock. And, of course, the questing adventure Miracle Rogue that RDU just lost with. Bunny Hopper still has that Freeze Mage, which I feel like is well-positioned against the lineup in general. Just, you know, Freeze Mage is very... good against Shaman, surprisingly. I know a lot of people felt like, wait, what? Isn't Shaman supposed to be favored against Freeze Mage? But that's back when Aggro Shaman, you know, the years of yore, aka last week and a half, Aggro Shaman was very much considered to be favored against Freeze Mage, despite Freeze Mage expert telling you otherwise. And then all of a sudden, now that mid-range Shaman's really popular, Freeze is all of a sudden back on the menu, very much strong against the classes remaining here.
If I would to pick a Shaman deck that was sort of the best against Freeze Mage out of all the Shaman decks in the Last Call for Europe, I would say it's RDU's. He's got a Rag in the deck. He's got a Bloodlust in the deck with a Wicked Witch Doctor. He can develop tokens.
Okay.
Totemic Might can bring things out of range of Blizzards or some of those board sweeps. So definitely his is the one to look for. You know, you look at the game earlier where he beat Reno Lock on turn 6. And sometimes Freeze Mage has similar starts, you know. If they're just drawing cards early, if they're not developing secrets, or they can't freeze your board and remove it with Frost Nova Doomsayer on turn 5, then sometimes you can just win on turn 6 if you get the right hand for it. And combine that with the fact that, like I mentioned, Ragnaros the Fire Lord can do crazy things against Freeze Mage.
Yeah, you can get 2 Ragnaroses through Barnes as well. Barnes being included in a lot of these mid-range Shaman variants. At first, we were a little bit skeptical, but after seeing it summon, you know, anything as innocuous as Flame Tongue Totems, Manti Totems, all the way up to Ragnaros and Thunderbolt Valiants, really powerful swinging cards, it's very well positioned to have a strong impact. And mid-range Shaman is so dynamic. It can be aggressive. It can also play a very slow, grindy game. It also can just play very tempo-oriented, depending on how it opens up as well, especially with things like Primal Fusion. You can have 1 mana, give +4/+4 really easily through all this Witch Doctor shenanigans, and all of a sudden it's just like this totem that's like 0/2 because of 4/6 and just gets out of control.
Yeah. Mid-range Shaman has been pretty dominant in like ranked play, but I think it does have a couple more vulnerabilities if you're playing in a tournament setting where you can ban it away or choose to target it. But still, it's performed pretty well today. We have seen some players struggle with the gameplay aspect of it. You know, one of the most important parts of Hearthstone is playing it.
You're right, TJ. Tell me more.
No, that's it.
Okay. It's true, man. You got to play. You got to hit that play button and do your best and forget the rest. You know, but all sarcasm aside, I think you're absolutely right. I think the fact that even though you feel like you've come this far, there's definitely been areas of improvement for all players, I think, just from the fact that you maybe even just, maybe not necessarily just play, but deck lists in general. And that's kind of what you have to do. You're going to make shift or make do with what you have, despite the fact that you're not dealt the perfect hand or you don't have the perfect deck lists. I do want to point out, by the way, that Bunny Hopper is, in my opinion, one of the gems from 2016. He also comes in as a player that the ACT system was able to find and really showcase. In the winter season, he did very well, being able to go all the way to the championship and win, go past the first round. And then he started doing well in other DreamHack events, too. In Swiss tournaments, he started going really far. So I feel like HCT has also shined a lot of light on him, despite the fact that guys like George C and Dr. Hippie get a lot of attention. Don't forget that Bunny Hopper came very close to qualifying in the previous season as well, in the summer season. He also has been doing well in other events, too. So even though people probably are pulling for RDU, and he's definitely the fan favorite in this head-to-head, don't be surprised by Bunny Hopper's results. A lot of players are starting to vouch for him and practice with him. You look like Super JJ, who's also been doing very well, very hot, streaky player towards the end of last year. Stan Sifka, a big fan favorite and a big-time control player. They're practicing with Bunny Hopper, and they love his style. They love the way he thinks about the game.
Yeah, and also Bunny Hopper is a player that a lot of Hearthstone players can look up to. You know, he plays. You could say that he plays Hearthstone full-time, but he's going after like a PhD. He like works full-time.
Yeah,
he's a super smart dude. So he can do it all, folks.
I think he was also an extremely high-level player in chess, too.
Yeah.
I don't want to say he was a chess grandmaster, but I think he played chess at a very high level.
I think he's also been to space.
Yeah, I'm kidding. I also heard he invented the cure for cancer.
He did.
Yeah, that's what he's studying for his doctor right now. Yeah. I heard he also bought a kid a bike.
And that kid was RDU.
Plot twist. Wow, that'd be quite the irony there. Shakespearean, if you will. Let's go into Shaman versus Warrior, a matchup that has changed a lot, despite the fact that it feels like not much has shifted in terms of the card list, but you know that mid-range Shaman has ended up being just this big thorn in Warrior side for a long time, historically. The fact that hero power and pass for Shaman is a legitimate threat to Warrior is always so frightening. But then you also have this fact that the Shaman deck can just explode with things like the Witch Doctor. So no matter how long you save your Brawl, the next turn could legitimately have six or seven minions on the board again.
Yeah, and you know, since Shamans can do a lot more with nothing as opposed to what they used to, the matchup has become a lot more interesting. You know, there is ways that the Warrior can win. Warrior, even though Shaman's gained more tools, so has Warrior. They've gained access to different kinds of removal. They've gained access to, you know, just different tools in general to combat the style of play. But a lot of times it feels like as the Warrior, you end up using your removal. You have to go like two for one as far as removal goes, and the Shaman just keeps playing threats that are, you know, medium-sized, but still very threatening to you, like Thunderbolt Vine or Azure Drake. Those are tough things to remove for Warrior, but things that can't stick on a board because of the implications.
Already a couple of interesting choices available to RDU. He picks up the second Totem Golem, but that plays directly into the Revenge in Bunny Hopper's hand. Or if it wasn't Revenge, it'd also be Ravaging Ghoul, and he's very well aware that Warriors tend to mulligan four cards like that, like Fiery War Axe and, you know, the Ravaging Ghouls and ways to answer the board early on. So very wisely choosing to just hero power, take it slow. No rush. You can Totem Golem hero power again. Not to mention that, you know, as time goes on, he's still reducing the cost of things from below. So Bunny Hopper, does he choose to use Revenge here, hold on to the weapon, or does he choose to take it a little bit slow as well?
He's going to Revenge. I guess he can't stomach the idea of Totem Golem dealing 9 damage to him. So just going to go with the revenge instead. But another Totem Golem is going to be played, and all of a sudden Bunny Hopper doesn't have a way to deal with this one. So
yes. You know, one thing I was about to point out is that there's also this increasing threat of things like Spell Power Totem increasing the power of Spirit Claws, but Bunny Hopper does have Harrison in a lot of his decks. We mentioned it in the Druid, we mentioned it in the Warrior, and that can be a factor if it lands on Spirit Claws. A lot of times, it's such a big swing. Yes, it's not six cards from Doomhammer, but two cards, or sometimes even three, is definitely also a big swing. Mm-hmm.
Totemic Might.
If you told me, TJ, in the year 2016, we'd see Totemic Might in a tournament deck not ironically or unironically, I'd slap you with a sea bass. That I caught myself.
I would expect
off a Fisherman's Wharf.
I would expect nothing less, actually.
Would you?
Yeah, if I had told you that.
Am I a fish slapping kind of guy?
I would be offended if you didn't slap me.
Yeah.
With a sea bass. I would. And you're right, you know, Totemic Might was once the laughing stock of a class which was the laughing stock of Hearthstone.
Yeah, you're completely right again. People used to use this card as like an example of how you can get a terrible card from the Shaman class. But in this instance, it's actually been used quite fearsomely. I mean, this is a rather resilient board, and if Bunny Hopper didn't have Brawl, Artie would be in a really dominant position. But Bunny Hopper does have that Brawl. However, it doesn't guarantee anything. It might have the Totem Golem survive as a 5-4, and that's still very annoying.
Yeah.
Or sorry, a 3-4 because of the totem buff. Mm-hmm.
So this is, it's so threatening, in fact, that it's probably going to have to be a Brawl.
Yes.
And just hope that one of the, I mean, they're all pretty decent minions to have survived the Brawl, and they're all minions that won't be able to be killed by the Fiery War Axe. So no matter what comes out of this, RDU, even though he's used a lot of resources to build up this board, two of those are just totems. And
yep, precisely.
He still has stuff to reload in his hand, like the Manatide Totem. He could, you know, try and hide behind something or set it side by side with something that's also really threatening. Mm-hmm. So instead, Bunny Hopper is just going to wait a little bit and, you know, go for a little bit of a greedier play, hoping RDU is going to extend more onto the board.
Which he will. I mean, that's what Shaman does. Even if RDU chooses the Hero Power and Hex, that increases the chances of a poor outcome for RDU with the Brawl. Because it's like you said, and something that I didn't even pay attention to until you mentioned, is that RDU set up his board on 5, that any outcome from the Brawl was still really inconvenient for Bunny Hopper. Mm-hmm. So that's a very astute observation from RDU to recognize that he can extend onto the board with Totemic Might. However, now if he hexes, how does he extend further? Does he Hero Power? Does he feel comfortable to play Manatide? Maybe he knows Bunny Hopper would bait him into it. But at the same time, hex into Manatide kind of produces the same result-ish. You get to draw a card, replace the Manatide, and the outcomes aren't that bad. The only bad outcome, ironically, is Manatide, because then the Fire War Axe gets found. Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, is there even an urgency to hex for RDU?
That's true.
Considering that there's a lot of good hex targets in this deck. Well, there's a few. You know, Sylvanas is one of them. Is he more threatened by that? Can he wait a turn? Can he try and, like, get the Brawl out before?
Look at this! RDU knows that Bunny Hopper's tendencies is to make his play inconvenient, so he chooses not the Hero Power, because once again, he recognizes that Bunny Hopper is trying to make him lower his chances of having a good Brawl outcome. So instead of rolling the opportunity of having a Healing Totem or a Searing Totem, which would be really inconvenient, he chooses not to Hero Power, which is very counterintuitive, a very good play from RDU.
Yeah, I mean, there's absolutely no point to have those two totems on board, pretty much, because, you know, what is having a Healing Totem really contributing to this style?
Yeah.
Of board. You know, the one thing maybe like a Bloodlust off the top that might get punished by this if
or
Bunny Hopper weren't to have Brawl or Thing from Below. But, I mean, he's already played so many totems that Thing from Below would be free, I think, right now, or at least one mana. Mm-hmm. Two Totem Golems, a Flamethrower Totem, Spell Power, Taunt, and he got a Searing Totem earlier, so it's already free. So that even adds on to the point that RDU, you know, made the right call here. So
Totemic Might is doing so much work passively that Bunny Hopper is just forced into awkward plays. And now RDU can start, you know, extrapolating of what his opponent's hand is. He has two Lightning Bolts to deal 4 damage. He has Flame Tongue as well. Is there an opportunity to lethal here, TJ?
He can also play Maelstrom Portal.
Let's see.
Maelstrom Portal, would Maelstrom Portal even make a difference? So he's pushing 5 to face with the Totem Column. 7 plus 4, 11 plus 5 now. I think he can do 16 damage maximum.
If I count 17 correct, damage.
17 damage maximum.
5, 9, plus 8, 17. 17 gets through. I think he's 2 off. Unless the Maelstrom Portal creates a charger? No, it's the boar, so maximum is 18, I think. Unless I'm forgetting some ways totems slide in. But my thought is that Flame Tongue Totem goes between the taunt and the spell power. Then you play Maelstrom Portal, the 2/4 attacks in. Yeah, it doesn't seem like there's a way, unless RDU is able to see the extra damage that we're not. But I think he's a little bit off.
I mean, RDU can keep the board exactly how it is, but just trade in with the spell power totem. He doesn't have to go. You know, he's still chipping away damage.
Once more.
That's still 3 damage that he just dealt to Bunny Hopper. If the board stays exactly the same and Bunny Hopper armors up and plays a minion exactly how he did the previous turn, then RDU will win. 7, 11, not quite. He'd have 15 total, but he'd be very close to winning.
He'd be very close with an opportunity to draw even more damage depending on what happens. Of course, Bloodlust is off the top, would be very powerful. Mm. RDU did overload on 7, so I think Bunny Hopper can at least interpret his hand to not have Ragnaros, so he can play around that possibility.
And he's got a brawl.
Yeah, it's just, you can't wait any longer. Now there's at least the outcome with the spell power totem, the 1/4, but the Flame Tongue totem survives, and that one's really annoying to deal with. You might just attack it anyways, just to make sure to chop that thing down over time.
Yeah.
Totemic Might, TJ.
So good.
Best card in the game. Mm-hmm. Dash Raynad 2016. You see, he's even thinking about executing it. Totemic Might for an execute is a fantastic trade. Not to mention that you force your opponent to brawl. Thunder Bluff Valiant off the top. When your opponent just brawled, he can start the process all over again.
Just brawled and executed.
Yeah.
Not bad.
Not bad at all. Always worth thinking about if you want to play something else. You have Mana Tides also to start climbing back into card count, grind your opponent out of the game.
It's actually really interesting. Because if you rolled a Taunt Totem, maybe you'd want to play Mana Tide this turn to try and make Thunderbolt Valiant more beneficial next turn. But then if you don't get Taunt Totem, you would have wanted to play Thunderbluff Valiant first.
Right.
And then even then, you might not put your opponent on having second Fireworks anyway, or, you know, say Grom.
Yeah, this play is not exactly the most obvious one either, because there is the value of playing these totems first before the Thunderbluff Valiant, so you can get more buffs on it. But I think in general, on average, Thunderbluff is just better.
Yeah, Thunderbluff then Totem is usually going to be better. Then you can play Mana Tide next turn and Totem up. He gets Taunt Totem anyway. Still really powerful, though, because really it means annoying. That Bunny Hopper is less likely to be able to kill the Thunderbolt Valiant. Because right now he has no way to deal with it. He doesn't even have many ways to like gain health. His hand is full of minions, mm-hmm. You know, one of which, N'Zoth, only brings back an infested Tauren. Grom, he might just have to slam the Grom here and hope that contests enough of the board to get him through.
Yeah, he did use one Hex already and a Lightning Bolt, so his removal options are limited. Plus, he has no totems to buff with the hero power. The Grom would be a 10-7 minion. Yeah, that's pretty hard to remove, so I would be in favor of that. I like that.
He could also go for like Fire War Axe and Sylvanas, but the Sylvanas doesn't even contest the Thunderbolt Valiant by itself going into the following turn. So he'd need like even something extra.
Yeah. Ravaging Ghoul. That also is a possibility too. I think what it does is it kind of complicates the board state. Thunderbolt Valiant can't build up too much tension and pressure. A second Thunderbluff.
Yeah.
5, 8, 9 damage. Oh, 11 if you got Stone Tusk Boar. Not the Flame Tusk.
Oh, yeah.
Some portal. You know, something to always consider, but nothing that's you can ever really truly go for because it's super unlikely.
It's actually not that unlikely. It's not as likely as people think. There's not that many one drops.
What's the chances of it?
I don't know.
RDU, well, now that Sylvanas is played, it's definitely awkward. If you choose to play the second Thunderbluff Valiant, he would complicate the board state significantly, so chooses instead buff his totems here, and hopefully his opponent steals a weak minion, so that way he can remove it very efficiently with Maelstrom Portal. And he gets it. Watch if this is Stone Dust Boar. Wow, that's
Flame
a pretty good
outcome. Still good, though.
Yeah, fantastic. Maelstrom Portal, of course, one of the MVP cards from the One Night in Karazhan expansion. As you can see it on the screen, it is able to summon a flame at very good value indeed. Or do you choose to play the Manatite on the far left, probably anticipating that the Thunderbluff Valiant would die first. And if his opponent attacks, spends his turn Fiery War Axing down the Manatite, I think he's okay with that, as opposed to making sure the damage gets done. Bunny Hopper picks up the Bash. So Bash, Shield Slam, Fiery War Axe removes pretty much all the damage threats on the board.
Yeah, but you still are, you know, have very little resources. Still at relatively low health.
Relatively low health, but Shaman's also kind of better resources, and you know that he played a Manti just out there on the empty board, which is one of the harder things to manage. In fact, he's even prioritizing removing it because he's going to try to grind his opponent out of the game, and he has the Nuzzob, which is super powerful. And I mean, RDU can't answer Nuzzob, so maybe Bunny Hopper's been able to survive the storm.
Yeah, and if he rolls a spell power totem here, and he's going to have two chances.
Oh,
there you go.
Oh, my goodness.
Got it.
And now he can also Primal Fusion the Flame Imp and do a lot of damage. Bunny Hopper's not happy to see that.
And Primal Fusion actually kind of doubles up with Wicked Witch Doctor.
Right.
He summons the totem first.
Yes. And he gets six damage on that Flame Imp. And Bunny Hopper is left to just pray for Nuzzoth or Brawl. Nuzzoth summons the
Infested Tauren,
but RDU's got the Thunderbluff Valiant, and that would be death.
You have to go for Tink Master Overspark to turn the Flame Imp into a 1-1. It's a 1 in 5 to target the Flame Imp.
I don't even know if that's enough, though, because Thunderbluff Valiant busts so much.
Yeah, the Thunderbluff Valiant would still be
3, 4, plus 6.
10. I'd be able to armor up.
He would be able to armor up.
But that's a very small chance.
And that's if he knew RDU's hand. Mm-hmm. Is there also a possibility he just plays Grom or Shellscream, trade and armor up as well? I think that's a possibility as well. I think Bunny Hopper has to weigh all of his options here. What's the play that most likely increases his chances to win?
Probably Grom, I'd have to say.
I don't know. There's a case for Nuzzoth as well because his board would be very strong. He has Cairn and Sylvanas.
Not Cairn. Cairn got hexed.
You're right. Cairn was hexed. So
but
it just beats Sylvanas
yeah.
and the Infested Tauren. In that case, you're absolutely right. I think the Grom Shellscream is better.
Yeah.
Oh, man. That Spirit Claws will do it.
I think it would have been it anyway, right?
Yeah.
7 plus 5, yeah. Or 7 plus 6.
So at this point, RDU is going to climb to a 2-1 lead.
Yeah, the Shaman showing its strength. I mean, it's a pretty scrappy deck.
It was a little bit close, though. I mean, RDU almost got gassed out. He needed every inch of that. And the Warrior also were stuck on some really awkward turns. I do want to, once again, put light on RDU's choice not to hero power a couple turns to really force a brawl out of his opponent and then build it back. Meanwhile, squeezing out damage with his Totem Golem. That 2-mana 3-4 end up dealing over a dozen damage. So it was really powerful in combination with the Flametongue Totem. Well-played game by RDU.
An elegant salsa dance around the brawl.
Yeah.
In that one. And with that, we're going to...
How festive.
We'll be right back for game number 4 after this. Welcome back, guys. We're about to jump into game number 4 in the series between RDU and Bunny Hopper. And I'm joined by Frodan.
Yeah, halfway point through the series. RDU is only two games away from going to the finals and just be at the doorstep of joining his teammate Tice. Of course, Bunny Hopper keeping the dream alive for three Virtus Pro players, which would be quite the story considering that all three of those players prior to the year starting were unsponsored and Virtus Pro was not even involved in the Hearthstone scene. Mm-hmm. And of course, the journey would continue from Naaman to Dr. Hippie and now to Bunny Hopper. Would be fantastic. Also, I want to put it out there that Dr. Hippie, the mysterious challenger himself, has promised, sworn on his life and his household, that if Bunny Hopper qualified for the Hearthstone World Championship at BlizzCon, he would dye his hair pink.
Pink. Yeah. That's right.
No comments from TJ, who has yet to dye his hair a different color. Yeah. You told me you were going to dye your hair, and you just kept it at the blonde.
I don't know, man. The problem with that is I'm just so indecisive.
Yeah.
Like, I wanted to go pink, but then it's like, everybody does pink.
Everybody does pink? One person does pink. And you're looking at them.
I know.
Anyway,
I was trying to trigger
you. That person has since rescinded that opportunity and gone purple instead.
Yeah. I decided that I should match my shirts to your hair instead of matching my hair to your hair.
Oh, gotcha.
I'm actually going to dye my hair based off what color shirt you're wearing. So then we got sort of like an opposites thing going on.
I hope you have a rainbow colored shirt for BlizzCon. All right. Well, going into game number four here, Bunny Hopper, he kept it just card true heart. Definitely can't approve of that, considering that life gain is one of the ways you can beat the rogue out, because eventually you do have the removals. He has two brawls for the two conceals in the deck. That is definitely a comforting thing for Bunny Hopper. He knows that he has a chance of demolishing his opponent's board. RDU is on the coin, though, and now he picked up one of the most important cards for being able to pressure the Warriors to Questing Adventurer. But ultimately, the Gadgetzan and the outcome of how he's able to pressure his opponent through how many card draws he gets will determine the game.
Yeah, it's very true. And he already has those tools already in his hand. So this matchup, of course, we've talked about it a few times throughout the day. A few of the casters have talked about it as well. I feel like this matchup's really close right now. You know, there's a lot of players who are in the school of thought that Warriors is a heavy favorite. There's a lot of players who are in the school of thought that Rogue is the heavy favorite. You know,
really?
I've talked to a lot of Rogue experts, and the ones that like really dive deep into the matchups, like Amnesiac, who is known as a Rogue player but can play just about anything. He's not like a Rogue loyalist. He says that the matchup is very close.
Yep, I can believe that based on the way the deck lists are checked out. Taking a look at RDU's Rogue list seems pretty standard. The one thing, of course, is not standard is the journey below, which we saw towards the end of game two, I believe, where RDU played it, didn't really get much of an option. I guess Anubarak is one of the game changers. Imagine if you can get that against Control Warrior. Just play Journey Below, get Anubarak. Perhaps you want something else, though, too, depending on how things go. Maybe Tomb Pillager. Look at RDU just immediately chopping away. Now, we've seen players do stuff like this, be really aggressive, sometimes shatter striking face, but I've yet to see Questing Avenger just play as a 2-2 against Control Warrior.
Yeah, and he realizes that it's not necessarily his win condition. He feels like he can't afford to do nothing this turn, and he's also double hedging against Harrison Jones because he knows that's a very likely keep against Rogue in a lot of situations because, you know, weapons are good. It also means that he attacks with the weapon too, so, you know, if he does play Harrison Jones, he gets one charge. And also, if he plays Harrison Jones, he doesn't answer the Questing Adventure.
That's clever, yeah. Forcing him to choose. Either play Harrison Jones and remove my charge, or let my Questing Adventure live. It's a very interesting proposition, and one that Bunny Hopper said, you know what? You win. I'm just going to let you keep that dagger. Of course, RDU has a choice of re-daggering at this point, too, or attacking. I think if he went for this line, he definitely wants to get rid of his dagger. Now, here's a question. Is he going to re-dagger if he attacks? Because if he doesn't re-dagger, then he's completely playing around the Harrison Jones and making his opponent's turn awkward, which I wouldn't mind.
But how much?
He has Gadgetzan Coin Conceal anyways.
But how much is too much?
That's a good point.
How much do you say? I understand attacking with the deadly poison because that has a lot of value, but that 1-2 dagger to you really doesn't have that much value. The value is, you know, giving your opponent cards.
Two cards.
Yeah.
It's really powerful. RDU seeing that his opponent plays just a card because Bunny Hopper values that life gain, but now here comes the Gadget Sand Train.
He's got double Gadget Sand and double Conceal. So RDU, we will see about his entire deck in the coming turns.
Backstab, get rid of a weapon charge. He's still going to be looking for other things. Leroy Jenkins, his Cold Bloods, his Questing Adventure number 2. No. Can also prep Fan here. Wouldn't hate that either, just to continue to draw. Not even take that damage. Get that one little poke to face.
Yeah, he knows that Bunny Hopper does run Tinkmaster over Spark, so getting immediate value out of Gadget and Auctioneer does have inherent value because of that. You know, Tinkmaster over Spark can rip a Gadget and Auctioneer out of stealth and turn him into a Squirrel or a Devilsaur.
That's true. The Tinkmaster over Spark tech.
Yeah.
The, you know, before RDU was known for being on G2 and doing all of his accomplishments, he was also known as a very strong Miracle Rogue player because he just played thousands of games with it. And I remember one of the most interesting things ever when I was first learning Hearthstone was listening to RDU describe the lines of play based off attacking on turn 2 as Rogue. Mm. Because there's so much debate for a long time. Like, should you attack with the dagger and then re-dagger, or should you not? Like, also there are complications. He spent like 15 minutes talking to me about why you should attack or when you should not attack with the Rogue dagger on turn 2.
It's interesting. You find yourself in spots where you're one damage off lethal for 50 games, and then you find yourself in a spot where you don't have a dagger charge to kill a really impactful minion about 50 games. Mm-hmm. And it's in those situations you realize that life is hard.
Yeah, and it's definitely not the easiest. Are you choosing to start things off with Cold Blood? I was kind of anticipating him to start with something else, but you know what? He's at full hand, so the problem is he can't like Journey Below because I think he would overdraw at that point. And now he's drawn the Questing Adventurer. He probably wants to play that with Eviscerate and then Conceal for the second time. Mm-hmm. So that way he can get that damage in with the Questing the following turn, forcing a Brawl from his opponent. If at all.
Yeah, I mean, it feels like it's a little bit of a waste of 2 damage, but like you mentioned, overdrawing. That minion from Journey from Below could be really important.
Yes.
I think that's how it works, right? You draw the card first, and then the minion would resolve afterwards.
So while people might be looking at the Cold Blood and say, he didn't get the value off of the 4 damage, so he missed 2/4 damage, you have to understand that RDU's hand was just too full at that point. First world rogue problems. Now, Bunny Hopper picks up that Tinkmaster over Spark.
He can Brawl and Tinkmaster for a guaranteed, not removal, but a guaranteed removal of both effects from these very powerful minions.
Sure. There you go.
And now both conceals are gone. That's about, you know, as much as you could possibly ask for from Tinkmaster.
Yeah, RDU's probably not hoping for this unless... Oh, a Devilsaur comes out. Yikes. I guess Bunny Hopper says, you know what, if that Questing Adventurer lived that turn, it would have been much bigger than a 5-5, so thank goodness that I was able to stem off that much damage.
Yeah. Tinkmaster over Spark. 3-mana Battle Cry. Oh. Limit your opponent's potential.
Yep, sounds like my high school teacher in a nutshell. Well, the Devilsaur is going to get in 5 damage here, and that's a 4-4-5-5-6-6. Bunny Hopper just used 1 Brawl as well, so definitely not a comfortable position whatsoever.
It's like Karakazam on steroids.
Karakazam. Yeah, actually, you're right. Because it'd be a 3-3 buff across the board. That's very strong. Second Brawl being forced out of Bunny Hopper, and he doesn't even have removal guaranteed.
Well, he got, potentially the best outcome. You know, Azure Drake has, it's the smallest body, but it has spell power attached to it. But
kind of.
Now Artie can just load up the board.
But potential, TJ. Azure
potential.
Drake has potential damage.
Oh, well, I guess Tinkmaster Oversparks Battlecry was wrong.
Well, I guess, you know, now he's healed a Devasaur, so in the end he just took 4 extra damage from Tinkmaster that he could have avoided. But how does Bunny Hopper now deal with this? Is he going to play the Infestator and try to get in the way of the Azure Drake? He's just going to equip the Fire War Axe and tank up. These are questions which are like a little bit harder to answer, but with Grommish in his hand, I feel like his answer for removal on the following turn is better. Oh, okay, so he chooses to remove this turn. This is how seriously he's treating the threats, because he knows that his opponent probably is drawn deep enough for Cold Blood.
Yeah, and he knows that he's actually been through a lot. He's been through both Conceals, he's been through both Questing Adventures and the Edwin Van Cleef.
Is that a Karen Bloodhoof?
Hello!
Oh my goodness. That is really strong against Warrior. They can't remove that easily.
Yeah.
Unless he's thinking about picking up Zeril for like some combo potentials, but I mean, Karen is really good.
Yeah.
Wow.
And Journey from Below ends up being a pretty good card.
Fantastic
on the day for
tech. And Matt, I mean, you have to wonder what Journey Below is intended for. And if you know that people are going to be bringing a lot of slower variants of Warrior, then of course you're going to use it to boost your matchups against it, or perhaps against other matches which are a little bit slower as well. Okay, so Bunny Hopper, what does he do from here?
Well, he's got a lot of very powerful minions in his hand,
yeah,
including Nuzoth. So maybe just drop some of these Death Rattles, try and get them rolling before Nuzoth is going to come out.
Yeah, I don't mind that.
Is incredibly powerful, but it is very vulnerable to Sap, in which you have seen zero.
Yeah, but you have to play it eventually. If you play the Infested Torrent and Sylvanas in the best case scenario, your opponent doesn't sap it, and then you could potentially do some Ravage Ghoul shenanigans with the Cairn. RDU has 4 plus the Leeroy and the Viscerate, which is 10, plus the Hero Power Dagger, that's 15, plus, well, SI can't squeeze in because of the mana, but as soon as he's able to do that, he has 17 damage.
So then what's the best way to go about this? So Sap on the Sylvanas is pretty much a given. Mm-hmm. So you're left with 8 mana.
I guess the double Pillager makes the cleanest. You could also play SI and remove and get damage with the Cairn as well.
Yeah. I kind of like just SI 1 and Pillager 2nd, even though it puts less power on the board. You're giving your opponent less resources, killing off the entire body of the Infested Tauren. This does use less mana and makes your burst potential, I guess, as the game progresses a little bit less. But I guess that the only potential that would be used for burst would be Leeroy Jenkins, Eviscerate, plus SA7 Age, which would be 12. If he ends up being 2 damage off lethal, then we can be completely results-oriented and call it a misplay. If you'd like. I mean, I'm up for it if you're up for it.
That's what we're paid to do, TJ. Use Caster Vision to spot that, but definitely can agree with the fact that he just has to load up as much board tension without overextending onto the board and cleanly removing. Bunny Hopper goes up to 20, so 4 plus the 14 still needs a little bit more in order to finish this game out. The thing is, Karen's showing off why he's strong. He can easily go for a trade here. Or you can just go for the tempo of playing Tomb Villager, eviscerating, and trying to get more damage in and making Cairn that much harder to remove. How many cards are remaining in RDU's deck, though? One of the problems could be that he might be too low on cards if he plays the slow game.
Well, he's got some damage left. I believe he has 1 Cold Blood, yes. 1 Deadly Poison. I got the best deals
anywhere. Thaunos, I think.
Thaunos. And
maybe another Drake. But either way, he still needs to be searching for some of that damage to finish the game.
14 cards left for Bunny Hopper. And 2. So it's just Deadly Poison and Drake, I think? Yeah. Has he used both Phantom Knives?
Actually, it could be a Phantom Knife number 2.
Yeah, but we're going to see here. There's the Deadly Poison.
Yeah. The Sap. So that he can play the Tomb Pillager as well. It doesn't matter if he's on Fatigue. It is Azure Drake. And that's a huge board from RDU. He's got 17 damage loaded up. Bunny Hopper doesn't have the brawls anymore.
But Revenge plus Ravaging Ghoul.
Oh. You're right. Revenge is something that we weren't thinking about in terms of the health activation.
I don't know. Is RDU going to have enough damage? He has... 10 from Leeroy Jenkins plus Eviscerate. 6 from Deadly Poison. So that's 16 total damage that he needs 2 turns to do. So that means he needs to piece together, 4 damage this next turn? So if Cairn survives and all Bunny Hopper does is armor up.
I'm trying to do some quick math here, assuming that he might even bash to gain health. Then he would be, I think he would be at 3 plus 4 is 19. 19 with 13 plus 4 is 17. He would be off, assuming he bashes here, and then just it tanks up. And I think RDU, he can squeeze in all the damage because he has the deadly poison. And Leroy, Viscerate, 10, 13, 17. Yeah, he's 2 off. But he has the...
coin doesn't matter.
So what he might end up doing is playing minion, deadly poison, dagger, and then remove and try to kill one more turn. But then he knows his opponent has Grommash still waiting. I mean, this is very, very close. And I think you said somewhere down the line, if RDU was 2 damage off at one point...
Oh, no! Oh, no!
If he was 2 damage off at one point, could we say that there's an opportunity for RDU to be more aggressive? Because he has 17 by my count right now.
My voodoo words.
Yeah, I mean, realistically, TJ, you could have been right. But RDU is trying to maximize as much damage as he can by using the Shadow Strike here, but he knows that one of these minions will certainly die to the Grommash.
Is it going to be enough, though? Yeah. Next turn, he has 11 damage from hand, plus the 14 on the board, actually, right. Or plus 4 on board, so it'll be 15.
Oh, but he doesn't have the way to remove every single minion on the board. He does have the N'Zoth, but I don't think... It only summons the Infested Tauren?
Infested Tauren, yeah.
Ravager Ghoul and Berengen is just 1 damage from clearing the minion, but you do 2 damage to yourself.
So if he armors up and kills the Azure Drake, he's dead.
Yes. If he plays Grommash, trades, but he knows the last cards. He knows that it's Leroy and Eviscerate and Thanos, which is the extra point of damage.
Even if it was just Leroy and Eviscerate, it'd be enough.
Right.
Because it'd be 17 totally, go up to 16. Mm-hmm. Because you'd only be able to kill off.
Yeah. Wow, what a close game. Super duper close. Warrior almost got to the finish line, but RDU stops him with 3 damage of fatigue. You don't usually see rogues go that deep.
Yeah, and Bunny Hopper has to know it. Got to be keeping track of those cards throughout the course of the game. And Leroy plus Eviscerate are 2 cards that you definitely keep close track of. So Bunny Hopper valiantly fought that one. A game of very little damage. Those players are both probably going to go back and look at that match and see what they could have done better, because there had to be plays for both players that could have made it not quite as close for RDU, or maybe even be able to sneak out a win for Bunny Hopper. Really intense, though.
Hearthstone's a game of inches, and you saw that was very close on both sides. That was red zone, you know? Both players could have sealed the game, I think, if a few different things lined up depending on how it went, but RDU being able to squeeze out as much damage reasonably without overextending, of course, and trying to calculate everything, ends up being just enough. But if he was off a little bit, we've seen Warriors be at 1 health, 2 health, and just tank up to 20 health right in a few turns because of shield block and the way everything's bounced back. Scary moments indeed on both sides. RDU is up 3-1, though, and 1 game away from going to the finals.
Yeah. Who's that coach, or was it a coach that made that Game of Inches speech? Do you know what I'm talking about?
Al Pacino?
Was it Al Pacino?
I think so. Something really inspiring. All I know is that I definitely felt motivated to get off the bed that day.
Yeah. I think someone should make a Hearthstone version out of that.
Sure.
Hearthstone
sure.
is a game of inches. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
You inspired me by the little, it's a game of inches.
All right, yeah. You're the motivational speaker here.
I am.
So motivate us to a nice little thing going into game number 6.
I don't know. They just come to me, man. I can't get them on demand.
All right.
Are you kidding me? You can't. The point of motivation is not to motivate people when they want to be motivated. It's to motivate people when they don't think that they need to be motivated. That's the key to life, really.
It's a great pasta in the making there. So RDU's down to his last deck. He's got the Warlock remaining. Now, this one was the bun that I believe Firebat had a big question mark over his head. Not because Zoo is a poor deck by any means. It's very efficient. It's good at what it does. But he wasn't sure specifically against Bunny Hopper how well this deck would do. So now that we've seen the Warlock and we see the remaining decks from Bunny Hopper, he's got his Freeze Mage, he's got his Warrior. I got to say, man, that I feel like Zoo definitely can take one of these games. But we have seen Zoo underperform, specifically even as recent as the Summer Championship, where it often was a liability.
Yeah, definitely. It's been a deck that has struggled. Players have stepped away from McPeters to take a little bit of a break. It's been a long series for them. Okay. While they do that, let's go ahead and take a look at sort of the road for these players to get to where they are now. They both made it to the semifinals, so they won their first quarterfinal match in the last call. But Bunny Hopper, player that made it to Winter Championship, got a big chunk of points there. But overall has had quite a varied road to get here with points from all over the place.
Yep. I look at those 2 points from the majors, and that might seem like not that big of an accomplishment, but Bunny Hopper did go pretty deep in some of those majors, being able to do well in DreamHack, for example, that I mentioned. And I feel like that's a really healthy distribution of points, showing that Bunny Hopper didn't just have one epic run. He didn't just do well in a couple of ladder season finishes. He was doing it all. Speaking of doing it all, RDU did actually win a DreamHack, becoming the only player to win, I think, 2 DreamHacks, or the first person to win 2 DreamHacks. Perhaps we can have another one in the upcoming ones soon enough. Also, of course, RDU did grind some of those Open Cups and, of course, finishing high many seasons on ladder as well. People kind of coming into this looking both at RDU for an opportunity to see some storyline. We want to remind people that in 2014, Romania was not eligible to enter BlizzCon, despite the fact that RDU did so well in so many tournaments. He was winning a lot of Open Cups. He was doing well in Invitationals. And then going into 2015, he had a little bit of a downturn. But in 2016, he's back with a vengeance because of the way the HCT system has revamped. And I think it's time for him to step up. I'm feeling an RDU victory, TJ. And I think your pick is about to go down.
You know what? I am going to agree with you as much as it pains my ego and, you know, what I wrote on that board. But I think you might be remembering things wrong. I think I wrote RDU on that board.
I'm pretty sure you wrote Bunny Hopper, and I'm pretty sure the internet never forgets. Your internet's a lot like your ex-girlfriend. They never forget. Bunny Hopper opens up with Fiery War Axe. Very strong opening against Zoo Warlock. It's actually exactly what Bunny Hopper was looking for. RDU kept, I think he full mulliganed. I can't remember exactly, but he did end up starting with 2 1-mana minions. However, he might be keeping the coin based off of his opening hand because he doesn't have a clean turn 2 play.
But that's a pretty good hand if you're a warrior player going up against a Zoo Warlock.
Yeah.
Having Fiery War Axe, having early minions to play, having that removal. Oh, geez.
Yeah.
I think I remember now. My board did say Bunny Hopper.
It's that's a pretty nasty start here. Bunny Hopper being able to have all the early game answers. Now, Ravage Ghoul is not as strong as it used to be against Zoo, primarily because the Zoo Warlocks have stopped running Forbidden Rituals. But there's still a lot of impact on removing some of these small, annoying minions like Possessed Villager. RDU has to now kind of weigh what he wants to do facing this Fiery War Axe. He does have Voidwalker to absorb the hit, so to speak, because he knows Fiery War Axe will get value anyways. Or if he chooses to play Imp Gang Boss, he somewhat plays into Ravage Ghoul. Ravage Ghoul at least leaves behind a 1-1.
There's so many things that you play into, no matter what you play against Control Warriors, since they have so much removals.
It's true.
You have to think about Slam, you have to think about Revenge, you have to think about Bash, you have to think about Execute, you have to think about Ravaging Ghoul. There's a lot of things that go through your mind, and sometimes you just have to make the most powerful play onto the board and think ahead to your future turns instead of, you know, making the most powerful play for that turn. What's going to make it more awkward for your opponent's removal if you do it this way? So he goes ahead and makes an interesting play in Voidwalker plus Possessed Villager, which actually puts the same amount of power on board as Imp Gang Boss, just sort of splits it up a little bit. But it's interesting to say the least.
Yeah, and I think Bunny Hopper knows that RDU is put in an awkward position. Zoo wants to use their coin way before turn 3 even, and now he's seen 3 turns of not using the coin, so Bunny Hopper has to interpret, one, either the Zoo hand is really awkward, or two, he's trying to stagger his threats to avoid his opponent getting a really optimal clear here. But the problem is that for RDU is that Bunny Hopper has pretty much everything he wants. He's got this, but I guess the only thing that's missing is a second Fiery War Axe.
Pretty much. And the kitchen sink. I think that's how that saying goes.
Well, it would be that Bunny Hopper's throwing everything at RDU in the kitchen sink. And it's not gotten to that point yet. I mean, Bunny Hopper's still going to be digging for a couple of cards. Brawl is usually really impactful. Execute's good for the Doom Guards, and then he'd feel really safe. But for now, I think he's chilling. Do you have the feels like he's a very safe spot.
Yeah, doesn't even feel like he needs to use these Ravaging Ghouls yet to try and take some power off the board. A 3-5 is pretty good. Ooh, this is getting awkward now.
Yes. RDU can set up a Darkshire Councilman that'll grow. And the Imp sets up for Doomguard to cycle the Darkshire Librarian and the coin. However, Imp might not survive, depending on how the Least Star Seeker trades. So he might just coin Doomguard. I know that sounds really silly, but if your opponent doesn't have it, then you can pressure your opponent pretty well.
Coin Doomguard, I feel like, is kind of the safe play in this situation, as weird as it seems. Holding on to the Doomguard to try and go for a better situation for it actually feels like the riskier play. You know, trying to wait for an additional benefit. And he's actually just going to flow to mana and hold on to all three of these to try and maybe combo the Imp with the Doomguard. He could go like Malkazar's Imp, coin Doomguard next turn.
Sure.
And
discard his next card.
Discard his two cards so he'd replace. If he picks up a Silver or Golem, he'd put himself in a really good position.
Ardy is a player that prides himself on Zoo play a lot. Very outspoken on the difficulty of the deck to play in tournaments. He thinks a lot of people are playing the deck improperly for tournaments and oversimplify it. He thinks I think he also even made a case that it's probably the hardest deck to play a couple months ago. Maybe it's since changed, the innovation of Malygos Druid and a few other decks which have seen a lot of play at the top level. But it's something that it's very clear. RDU loves to play the Zoo, and he does perform better with it than other people. So him being able to spot things like the Malkazar's Imp, coin, Doomguard, allows him to put on pressure and keep his options open for the following turns. I like it.
Yeah. But Bunny Hopper continues to throw out his onslaught of removal spells as he gets a good early game. Oh, ooh.
Okay, that's a little unfortunate the way that Soulfire gets discarded by the Doomguard. But at the same time, you get to cycle it, so it's not the worst thing in the world. So playing the Doomguard, and you can trade into the Lee Starseeker, play around the Brawl, draw two more cards. Oh man, imagine if Civil War Golem was able to come out. That would have been really nasty.
Yeah. But Bunny Hopper once again has the answer to this with Ravaging Ghoul plus Execute. We'll leave the Malkazar's Imp up, which could be risky in some situations, but having seen one Soulfire discarded, having seen the Darkshire Librarian discarded, having seen one Doomguard played, you're much more comfortable with leaving it up. Not that he had a choice, but he's not going to feel, you know, too threatened by it. Oh, double Civil War Golem.
Yeah, it's a little clunky. He doesn't have that Doomguard immediately.
Soulfire pickup from this would be pretty good. He could play one Civil War Golem out of his hand.
Sure.
And then Soulfire, use up all of his mana.
Yeah, you're right.
Be able to clear off the board. Yeah, still draw a card off it as well. Doesn't pick it up, though.
Another Imp. I wonder how good the Ghostshire Footman is to kind of complicate the trading from Bunny Hopper because he has a Ravaging Ghoul up.
Yeah.
Difficult spot, because once again, Control Warrior has more cards, enough of a life total to feel comfortable. RDU has to life tap. He's ready to use some of his bigger threats like Doomguard. Chooses the second Imp here in case he draws more discard, but it's definitely not a desirable position for RDU.
I was going to say, how much faith does he have in the top of his deck? And the answer is going to be quite a bit, and he's going to pick up a way to at least deal with the Ravaging Ghoul and still replace his Imp with something a little bit different. Might even hold on to it to try and, you know, get greedy once again and hope that he gets a discard effect next turn, because if he does, imagine if he picks up a Doomguard next turn. Doomguard, draw two cards, and have a very likelihood, you at least get one Civil War Golem, have a pretty decent chance of getting two.
It seems like a pretty good position to drop Barrageddon. Just clear the board as much as you can. Malkazar's Imp lives, but you know your opponent's running a little bit dry on resources. That's not what RDU wants to see. Possessed Villager, very weak. One of the weakest draws in RD's deck. Wouldn't blame to see a life tap here.
Yikes.
Yeah, and it just feels like the Control Warrior is very, very safe from this point on. Not to mention that Bunny Hopper picked up Jeskar Trueheart. So if in the case where he's able to win the board, Bunny Hopper is able to just sit back and use tank up to get out of range.
Yeah. And well, he can go for Ravaging Ghoul and then hit face and deal 9 damage this turn.
Yeah.
That seems pretty good.
This is the turn where Bunny Hopper decides to go aggressive against his opponent, and RDU is going to be stuck in a defensive position with no real comeback. Cards like Forbidden Ritual used to be a comeback card, but RDU opting to go for more things like tempo with Silverware Golem and the discard mechanic doesn't really have that availability. I mean, he could pick up Soulfire here, which would be pretty useful if he discarded the Silverware Golem, but he's still really far behind in the grand scheme of things. But it's still an option. If he plays, if he taps into Soulfire, he can Knife Juggler twice, play the Soulfire, and then the Juggles could potentially clean up the mess, rest of this mess.
Yeah. Can't quite do it now, and I think he is dead no matter what. Yeah,
just concedes at this point, and that's going to wrap it up. So quite the one-sidedness from the Control Warrior based off the Fiery War Axe, the Ravaging Ghoul cleaning up in the early game. But, I mean, I don't know how optimistic RDU was about the game, considering that the Fiery War Axe Ravaging Ghoul start was so powerful.
Oh, yeah.
Bunny Hopper.
That's one of those new games where it's really hard to get back into it. You sort of need to take risks and go for those big discard plays where you, you know, just play minions out into the board and they don't have response to it. But the Zoo may be showing some signs of weakness, so we'll see if RDU can pick up a win and move on to the finals right after this. Hey guys, welcome back. My name's TJ, joined by LeFrodan.
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 Yeah, that's right.
Since we're in, you know, the Europe last competitional.
That's right. No French players have qualified for the top 8, but we do have a Romanian and a German who, I guess, also studies in Norway and has a lot of Norway friends. So you can sort of cheer for him if your Scandinavian region can feel like he is an honorary member of the Norwegian crew as well.
Yeah. Definitely true. And he's lived there for quite a long time. I believe he's getting his PhD there.
Yes, he is very smart.
He's
good at Hearthstone.
A big contributor to society.
Yeah, that's right. I would trust Bunny Hopper to write some Wikipedia articles.
I would. I would as well.
Probably has. So going into game number 6 here, we have Druid versus the Zoo Warlock. This is a matchup where I think Zoo Warlock actually can win. A lot of times people look at Zoo Warlock in the tournaments and they think, isn't that just a lot of bad matchups? What is Zoo actually good at? It's actually very good at pressuring Druid. And if you expect Druid to be a very common class in the tournament, then it definitely has that matchup advantage. However, if Bunny Hopper is able to stave off the pressure with cards like Fandral and opportunity to swing with Living Roots and Innervates and other things with Fandral, it's very, very, very difficult for the Zoo to come back.
Oh, yeah. So next couple draws are going to be pretty crucial for Bunny Hopper as he's going to try and stabilize. But RDU does have Darkshire Councilman. It's a very tough card for Druid to deal with. Oh, man!
Yeah, it's not a very good start here for RDU. But Bunny Hopper feeling pretty good because he's got the Fandral with opportunities and flexibility. At the same time, Fandral doesn't guarantee anything next turn. It's just a 3-5 that happens to draw 2 cards. Swipe is also awkward. Losing a lot of power in this matchup because of, once again, Forbidden Ritual being unpopular at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of removal that lines up sort of awkwardly now. And you can tell with Bunny Hopper just playing Fandral on the board, it's most likely going to get answered considering RDU has 4 cards. Really only needs 2 minions to be able to play to kill it off at some point. And RDU is, he's nodding his head. He's like, yeah. I have Direwolf Alpha plus Abusive Sergeant, which is just those by himself is enough for me to kill off this this Fandral.
Yes, and Bunny Hopper not happy to see that at all. Swipe still not clean removal. RDU thinking about positioning with the Argent Squire, most likely far right, so that way if the Argent Abusive Sergeant dies, you can have it slide in.
There is some maybe some merit to left side, just because the Darkshire Councilman is the most important minion to remove.
Right.
So you figure your opponent is going to want to try and remove that at all costs.
Right. Feral Rage, for example.
Yeah.
Make it more important. But I think if your opponent Feral Rages, you're in a really good spot.
You're in a really good spot.
Also,
yeah.
The thing is, if he does do that, Defender of Argus gets better on the far right, so that way you can attach it to the Divine Shield and a minion. A lot of times you're stuck in this position because of the way Direwolf Alpha wants to be in the middle, that you have to Defender a Direwolf Alpha, and you actually kind of want to protect the Wolf because of the way it buffs passively. So this is actually a better lineup for Defender as well.
Yeah. And there's not really many summon effects anymore from Warlock, which you'd need the right side to be open, like Forbidden Ritual. Silver Ward Golem being spawned from a discard effect would be sort of like the only case where that would make a difference. So we talked about positioning for a while, but it's actually incredibly crucial in a lot of situations in Zoo. There's a lot of damage missed from players mispositioning minions in the deck, whether it be an inefficient Defender of Argus or Direwolf Alpha target, things of that nature.
Are you definitely tempted to kill the Emperor Thorsan? I'm kind of wondering if there's a position where he can just be aggressive and go everything to the opponent's face. He would put 13 damage and put his opponent down to 10. It is risky because you know your opponent has Emperor Thorsan, but at the same time, you're pretty much intending to kill him, but he doesn't have Soulfire or Doomguard in hand, so I think he probably will end up trading, but I think it's worth evaluating if you want to be aggressive this turn.
I mean, the trade's not bad. You know, the 3-2 Argent Squire after the Defender of Argus buff and the Divine Shield from the Argent Squire into the Emperor Thorsan is not that bad. He's going to go face with the two that he knows are going face first, evaluate, you know, see the health total, visualize the health total, go after the health total.
Okay. It's one of those things where he's out of time, so he doesn't have any more, you know, seconds to manage or think about it. And we see, based off the swipe in the Living Roots, maybe even the Raven, I know that there was a chance for a really bad clear to happen. Oh, Starfall would have been really nasty, too.
I mean, Moonfire is pretty good. Does Moonfire make this a full clear? He could swipe Moonfire down the Darkshire Councilman.
Okay.
He'd leave the Direwolf Alpha up, I believe, in that situation. Because he'd still be able to Hero Power down. So he'd Moonfire the Darkshire Councilman, swipe the Darkshire Councilman, Living Roots the Defender of Argus, and then Hero Power down the 2-1 Argent Squire. Well, it'd be a 3-1 Argent Squire, so I'd probably need to sequence that a little bit differently.
He could also have taken Starfall and just Living Roots. He could have done it for 5 damage to the Darkshire Councilman, Living Roots, that way save. But I kind of like this a lot better with the swipe.
Yeah.
So Bunny Hopper are going to stabilize a little bit, but he's taking so much damage. The good thing, though, is his giant's getting cheaper and cheaper. So in the event where RDU kind of whiffs on being able to put on more pressure, Bunny Hopper might be able to turn the tide soon. Because, you know, very realistically, next turn, if Bunny Hopper picks up another swipe and RDU doesn't have much going on, Bunny Hopper could swipe and play the giant. It's all realistic. A Doomguard. Really powerful pickup here from RDU.
It's powerful, but he's also discarding two powerful cards, and he's not reloading at all. So, if those minions get answered, so let's say this turn he would push 8 damage, so he'd put Bunny Hopper down to 6.
I like it.
If Bunny Hopper hero powered and took out the Direwolf Alpha, he'd be down to 5, which would mean he'd die to the Doomguard anyway, so yeah, I do agree with it.
Yeah, and I mean, Bunny Hopper, he has to be able to deal with that Doomguard, but I mean, he doesn't have that mulch in hand, so he's going to go Nourish to try to see if he can draw for it. It's a tournament life on the line.
Mulch or bust, I think.
Wrath doesn't pick up anything.
And I think that's it.
Oh, he can Wrath and put it down to 5 attack. He's still alive.
What is he going to get?
Innervate for the giant. Oh, he passes, and RDU's 1 damage off. He gets it. He's going to the finals. And the dream is alive, eliminating the remaining Virtus Pro member. A job well done to RDU as he keeps G2s alive for their second player in BlizzCon.
Yeah, it knocks out Virtus Pro's chance of having 3 players at the World Championship. Yeah. So we talked about the team rivalry. Even if it isn't sort of amongst the players, it's sort of a rivalry on the surface just because of the storylines the players bring into it. So
you never know. We could be looking at the beginning of many chances of battles between Virtus Pro and G2. It's very poetic that they're both from the Europe region, that both these teams have continued to seed their players in through the championships. His job's not done yet, though. Artis has to win one more series. He's waiting the winner of the opposite side of the bracket. But he comes in as a number one seed. And, I mean, he's one series away. What a crazy journey it's been so far for him.
He's proven that he belongs there so far. But to give you guys a deeper look at that match, as well as preview the second semifinal, let's send it over to the boys at the analyst table.
Thank you, TJ. I am here with Savitz, and incredibly impressive win there from RDU. I think, you know, too often we say, you know, he played really well, he played fine, he didn't make any mistakes. I think specifically in terms of that series, we have to point out that RDU was just playing out of his mind in that series.
Yeah, absolutely. That was my favorite series of the day. It was truly wonderful to watch, especially the Starman game against Bunnyhop, that from RDU against Bunnyhopper's Warrior.
Right.
The way he played on Brawl, passing turn, not playing anything, not even his hero power. It was really incredible.
Really was. You can see there, RDU takes the top spot in the grand finals, awaiting the winner of Pavel versus George C, which will be our game coming up next. But before we get onto that, let's take a look at some of the highlights of the game. This is RDU making his finishing push with that Shaman game that he just played perfectly throughout, the perfect amount of pressure with the perfect amount of resources left back in hand that he could use to beat Brawl, and then followed that up with a rogue victory that came right down to the wire with the last bit of damage that he needed. And remember, early on, he actually played a questing adventurer to block Harrison so that he could get a second deadly poison charge through. That little extra bit of damage ended up making all the difference, as you can see here.
It was so close in the end, like Thinkmaster Overspark, just giving it a 5-5. Like, if that was a 1-1, it could have been a different result.
Sure could. And there you go, the Dire Wolf Alpha that kept RDU and G2 Esports dreams alive of going to the grand finals, getting that one extra damage that he needed. But RDU, probably the favorite coming into this, definitely the most storied tournament player, the guy that, you know, was leading points coming into this and did it off the back of 0 points from championships, which can give players a big boost if they've been here before. So no surprise to see him doing incredibly well. But commiserations to Bunnyhopper as well. How do you feel like Bunnyhopper performed?
I think he played well. There was that one moment in the Warrior vs. Shaman matchup where we felt like maybe the first revenge was used a little bit early. He could have maybe saved it, just go for the tank up and take. There was only a 4-1 Drake from his opponent on the board, so and two Ravaging Ghouls in the hand. So it seemed a little bit unnecessary. So if he saved that one, maybe he would have won that one. But there's a lot of like ifs. And overall, I think Bunnyhopper had a really strong show and played well.
But we do have